Sorry, everyone, we're just waiting for our screen to catch up to us. Service today. It is the 12th Sunday after Trinity, and I want to greet you with the watchword for this week. It comes from Isaiah chapter 42, verse 3. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not snuff out. Please, can I ask you to have a look at the announcements? I just want to highlight a couple of them. First of all, our latest newsletter has been published. It has been distributed electronically to our members. There are several hard copies available in the hall, so when you enjoy a cup of tea afterwards, please find them there and feel free to take one. Today, after the service, we have our half-yearly general meeting. We have a few elections that we have to do. I also want to share some thoughts with you about the way forward, particularly when it gets to the point that Rolf leaves to go to the US, And then there are also several updates in terms of things going on in the congregation. That includes the finances. And speaking of that, I just wanted to say a very big thank you to everyone for the contributions that you make. You will see on the update there that at the end of July we are ahead of our budget for the year. In German we would say, Gott segne, gebe und gaben. That means, may the Lord bless those who give and the gifts that are given. Thank you very much. Then we also have a birthday boy amongst us today. Zach, happy birthday. I hope you have a wonderful day today, and I hope that your family spoils you properly, but more than that, that God blesses you today and in the year that lies ahead. I think we should sing happy birthday for him.
Happy birthday to you.
Wish us all a very blessed service today, and I'd like to carry on with a prayer, and I want to begin it with words from Psalm 147. Let's pray. Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise Him. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars and calls them each by name. Great is our Lord, and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. The Lord sustains the humble, but casts the wicked to the ground. The Lord delights in those who fear Him and put their hope in His unfailing love. Lord, as we just prayed with these words of the psalm, your love is unfailing. We come to you today and we ask you to take from us what blinds us to your truth, what stops us from hearing your call to serve you and those around us, and what makes our hearts fear. We ask you to do that today, through this service, through your word, through music and fellowship. Amen. Let's sing the next two songs, and I invite you to stand for that, and let's worship together.
Yeah.
Right, please have a seat, and can I ask the children to join me in the front? Right. Tell me, who of you enjoys celebrating a birthday? Not everyone gets the chance every day, but it's something nice, right? Do you count your birthdays? Do you know how old you are? How old are you? So, how old? Yeah, 3. See, we count our birthdays. As time passes, it's important to us how many candles are in the cake. We people count time. Did you know that the Bible tells us that our time is in God's hands? All the time, all those years we count, everything that happens in that time, it's all in God's hands. And so are you. In God's hands. Don't forget that. Let's pray. Lord, we want to thank you that our times are in your hands, and that your hands are good hands that carry us and guide us. And as the children go to children's church now, we ask you to guide them. We ask you to teach them and bless them. Amen. Amen. Right, you can go off to children's church. We are going to sing one more song before we hear the readings, and I ask you to stand for that. have a seat for the reading.
Good morning. The first reading is taken from Acts chapter 9, the verses 1 to 20, and it's entitled Saul's Conversion. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priests and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could not see anything. He could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias." "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man named from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hand on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And he has come here with the authority from the chief priests to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go, this man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately, something like shackles fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, he regained his strength. Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. At once he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. The second reading is taken from the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 7, verses 31 to 37. The healing of a deaf and dumb man. Then Jesus left the vicinity of Tyre and went to Sidon, down to the Sea of Galilee and into the region of Decapolis. There some people brought to him a man who was deaf and could hardly talk, and they begged him to place his hand on the man. After he took him aside, away from the crowd, Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears. Then he spat and touched the man's tongue. He looked up to heaven and with a deep sigh said to him, "Ephphatha," which means "be open." As at this the man's ears were opened, his tongue was loosened, and he began to speak plainly. Jesus commanded them not to tell anyone, but the more he did so, the more they kept talking about it. People were overwhelmed with amazement. "He has done everything well," they said. "He even makes the deaf hear and the dumb speak." Here ends the reading.
We have heard two passages from God's Word. God's Word is something which we hear. It shows us something, reveals things to us, and then it asks us to respond, and ultimately to respond with faith. That's why when we hear these readings, we generally respond with an expression of faith. It's called a creed, and the one we're going to use today is an ancient one, the Apostles' Creed. Let's confess that together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the realm of the dead. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the dead, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please stand as we sing the next song in preparation for the sermon. Grace be with you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I'd like to read a passage to you from the Gospel of Mark in chapter 8. It's the verses 22 to 25, and we'll use that as the sermon text for today. They, that's Jesus and his disciples, came to Bethsaida, and some people brought a blind man and begged Jesus to touch him. He took the blind man by the hand and led him outside the village. When he had spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him, Jesus asked, "Do you see anything?" He looked up and said, "I see people. They look like trees walking around." Once more, Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes, and then his eyes were opened, his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. Lord, we ask you to bless the speaking and hearing of this word now. Amen. Please have a seat. Tell me, do you check your tires regularly? I see some people have just realized that they don't. If you do you do it properly? I had an experience a few years ago when I took my car for a service. Everything went pretty much like planned, except the mechanics picked up something that I hadn't. I did check my tires regularly, but I would kind of just walk up to the car, bend over a little bit, have a look, maybe even touch it with my fingers and see, you know, is the tread all right? And then walk away satisfied everything looked pretty good. I thought I was checking my tires and that I was seeing that they were in good nick. The problem with that, though, is that I wasn't looking at everything. The tires were actually totally worn, but they were worn on the inside, where I couldn't see with my, shall we say, less than thorough inspection. I learned from that, and I make a bit more of an effort to check properly now. I could do something about it when somebody pointed it out to me, change my tires, but also adjust the way that I was behaving up to that point so that I don't get into the same trouble again. The passage that I read to you just now is about a miracle. Jesus makes a blind man see. It's a simple story of Jesus healing this man. It's a miracle. It is amazing. But it's also the sort of thing that Jesus was doing a lot. I mean, we hear that both in the second reading we heard and this one I read to you now, that people brought people to Jesus and asked him to touch them because they knew he was doing this. The way Mark uses this story, though, says something more. And I want to point that out to you today. It has to do with seeing and not seeing. Just before this story, we hear about the feeding of the 4,000. Jesus does this incredible miracle, and afterwards, he heads across the sea with his disciples. And we read that the disciples forget about bread. And they've only got one loaf. Now they've just experienced that miracle. What do the disciples do? They worry amongst themselves that they've only got one bread. And Jesus turns to them and says, "Do you still not understand? I fed the 5,000 with five loaves. How many basketful of pieces were left over? How many did you pick up?" And they go, 12. "Then I fed the 4,000 with seven loaves. How many basketful of pieces did you pick up?" Seven, they say. "And you still don't get it?" You see, the disciples didn't see. They could see physically. They didn't see spiritually. Then we hear of Jesus healing the blind man. And after this miracle, Jesus and his disciples visit different villages, and Jesus asks the disciples, "Who do the people say that I am?" And the disciples say, "Well, they say John the Baptist, they say Elijah, they say maybe one of the other prophets." And then Jesus says, "Who do you say that I am?" And then Peter, one of these disciples who didn't see, says to him, "You are the Christ." He's recognized something, seen it, and he believes. The others are still blind, but Peter sees. The story is about more than just the story of Jesus healing a blind man. The story is that, a story about Jesus healing the blind man, but we are also meant to recognize that this is about seeing and not seeing spiritually. It's about us being spiritually blind. Now, I just want to add this too. The Gospel of John does this a lot. It relates a physical sign to a spiritual message. After the miracles in John, and there are several that John tells us about, including Jesus healing the blind man, we hear all about people repeatedly who do not see. People who are shocked by Jesus' teaching, people who chase him away and want to stone him, Pharisees who do not believe either spiritually or even in the physical thing that happened. They don't believe that a miracle took place. They don't get it. They don't see. Again and again we hear about these people who are spiritually blind and cannot recognize who Jesus is. And in the middle of all that, in both the Gospels of Mark and John, lies this story of the miracle that Jesus did. And the blind man who was healed, who first couldn't, but now can see. In John, we hear after this miracle that the man is confronted by the Pharisees. They insist that Jesus is not a man of God. And this man who was healed says, "I disagree. This man is a prophet. He is a man of God. I was blind, but now I see. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." What's the reward the man gets for making that statement, that confession? He gets chucked out by the Pharisees. And when Jesus then finds him, the spiritual point is made very clearly. He asks this man, "Do you believe in the Son of Man, in the Messiah?" He is speaking to you now. And the man responds and said, "Lord, I believe," and he worshipped him. Both times, in Mark and in John, the story is followed by somebody making a confession. "Lord, I believe. You are the Christ." Do you see? The blind man wasn't just healed so that he could see physically. He also saw spiritually. He understood who Jesus was. He responded to him in faith. And the same is true of Peter, who, although he wasn't physically blind, he did not understand. And then he sees, understands, and confesses, "You are the Messiah." It's still made obvious that the crowd and the Pharisees who taught them, though they could see physically all along, remain spiritually blind. Right. Now, why am I telling you all of this? What about us? What about you? This whole question of being blind or of seeing also confronts you. Do you see? Who do you think Jesus is? Do you believe in him? Do you believe that he is the Messiah? Lord of lords? Lord over the living and the dead? The one to whom all knees shall bow, all tongues confess? And more than that, do you listen to him? Do you hear what he calls you to do? And hearing, do it. Do you obey his commands? Do you do what he calls you to do? Where are you blind? What do you need to see? Those are important questions. And I really want to encourage you. Think about them. Seriously, deeply, honestly, in conversation with God, in reading His Word and hearing it. Don't just kind of bend over, have a look and maybe run your fingers over the tread, and go away satisfied that you've checked. Go deeper. Look more carefully. Check on the inside too. It's not necessarily so easy to see. Just like on my car, we need to do that regularly. We need to do it as individuals, as families, as a congregation, as a church, as the body of Christ in this world. We need to recognize what's good and continue with it. If the tires that we're busy with are taking us down the road well and they are in good nick, then let's keep using them. But if you see a bit of wear and tear, then you need to adjust something. Maybe you need to replace something. We need to change what needs to be changed. We need to be renewed all the time. And the good news is, we can be renewed. In small things and in big things, God is a God of renewal. We heard in the watchword today that He does not break us when we're bruised or snuff us out when the wick is just still smoldering. No. He cares for us. He heals, renews, gives second chances, brings the flame in us alive again so that it burns. We heard that long reading about Paul and his conversion. That was incredible renewal. The one who persecutes Christ and His church becomes the instrument through which He works, through which Christ works. We heard in the second reading, Jesus makes a real change in someone's life, a physical one. It has a spiritual impact. And the people say, He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf hear, the mute speak. He heals the blind. He renews. And you and I need that too. Our congregation needs that too. Again and again and again. Continuously. So let's keep checking our tires. Ultimately, it is about Jesus Christ, about God speaking and working through Jesus Christ, through His Word, and about us hearing and seeing and believing. And that's no mindless swallowing of all sorts of facts and ideas. It's knowing God, seeing God, trusting God, and then doing what He calls us to do. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love. God loves you. And He offers you the opportunity for new beginnings. The means for new beginnings. He acts in grace and mercy and forgiveness. And you get to start again. He asks you to love Him. To love others as you love yourself. And to live as if you love Him and others and yourself. And when you fall short of that, which you will, you get to start again, to be renewed. Do you see that? or are you blind? Let's think about that today. And like the friends of the blind man in our story, like the friends of the deaf man in the second reading, let's go to Jesus and ask him to touch us and open our eyes. Amen. Lord, where I am blind, please help me see. And the peace of God, which is so much greater than we can ever understand, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We are going to sing the next song. I'd like to invite you to stand for that. As we sing that song, the thank offering will be taken up. We're going to say a prayer now. You are welcome either to remain standing or to take a seat. Let's pray. Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. We recognize so many things that you bless us with. We ask you to open our eyes so that we see them and remember to thank you for them. We bring you this thank offering today as a sign of our thanks. And we ask you to bless it and bless its use so that your kingdom will be furthered. Lord, we recognize that we are not perfect. We don't always see as we should. In our daily lives, in our families, in our various relationships, we act in ways that sometimes chase people away, that hurt them, that make it difficult for them to love us, and that ultimately put strain on and even break relationships. We recognize that many of the things that we people do fall short of your glory. And they bring with them many things that make this world not better, but worse. And so in a time of silence, we want to come before you and reflect on these. We want to reflect on our lives and confess to you what we need to. We ask you to help us to see where this is necessary in our lives and where we need to change. Thank you that you still love us, Lord, and treat us graciously. We are accepted as we are. You cleanse us. You do guide us and do those things we just sang about. Now give us the courage to leave here and to live what we have heard. We entrust into your hands all of those we care for and love, and even those around us that we do not know, those who are ill and in need of healing, those who are lonely and depressed, those who are frustrated and who don't know what the future will bring, those who have made themselves guilty and have hurt others because of it. We ask you to bring healing and comfort, peace and forgiveness where it is necessary. We ask you to help people to see. Help us to treat others graciously enough that we can help where there is need. Today we also pray for your church and all the world. Let your word be preached faithfully and let faith be put into action. Let your church be the town on the hill that is seen and the light on a stand that gives light to everyone in the house. Let us live according to your calling on our lives. We pray for our general meeting today and for the road that lies ahead of us as a congregation. Always help us to see, guide us, use us, mold us. We also pray for our church and the synod that is taking place in 8 weeks' time. Bless the preparations and the meeting itself and guide us there too, so that our church keeps becoming more what you want it to be. As we close our prayer, we do it expressing our trust in you, the trust of children in their loving Father, by speaking the words that our Lord Jesus Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And so as you go into this day and in the week that lies ahead, go in the peace of the Lord and under his blessing, knowing that you are in his hands. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. For the last song, if you would like to, you can have a seat. I also just want to say that after the service, people are always available to pray for you if you would like to individually. It can be something you need or also something you want to give thanks for. Dieter Depper is available today for that. So normally he'll be hanging around here. You can approach him, and then there's some rooms available to go to for prayer. I also just wanted to say that if any guests would like to know more about our congregation, as you go out, there's a little slip that you can fill in, visitors' cards that say, here's our contact details, we'd like to know more. There are a few options for you to tick there. And then after this song, we can head to the hall and enjoy a cup of tea and coffee together.